Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us today. I'm Zia Khan. I'm the Vice President for Initiatives and Strategy at the Rockefeller Foundation. It's a real pleasure to have you with us here today for the Next Century Innovators Awards, a chance to recognize the incredible innovative work that is happening across philanthropy, development, and business. In so many ways, the innovators that we're here to celebrate today typify the spirit that inspired the Rockefeller Foundation's very beginnings and continue to motivate us as our 100th year draws to a close. Recently, I was asked a very seemingly simple question, which is, why is innovation so important? And underneath that question, I think, was, why do we spend so much time and resources on innovation when sometimes incremental improvements to existing solutions would be much less risky and take much less effort? It was a really good question, and it made me think for a while. I came up with an answer, but before I share it with you, and I'll be curious over lunch and the rest of the day to hear your thoughts on my answer, let me tell you an illustrative story from our past. In the early 20th century, one of the Rockefeller philanthropies was dedicated to improving education in the United States, with a particular focus on the rural South. As the team spent more time in schools in the South, it became clear that a student's achievement was dependent on their health. Hookworm infection in particular was the culprit for missed classes and poor performance. In many rural counties, the infection rate was close to 60%. So a commission was formed in 1909 with a donation of $1 million. And over 5 years, it was the stated purpose of the commission was, and I'm quoting, to bring a cooperative movement of the medical profession, public health officials, boards of trade, churches, schools, the press, and other agencies for the cure and prevention of hookworm disease. Now, this is a pretty remarkable frame of systems thinking before we even had the term systems thinking. But this wasn't the only goal of the commission. This rampant yet easily curable disease provided what was described as a favorable wedge, allowing the commission to promote the creation of an organized and well-funded public health network across the southern United States to solve future health problems. When the commission eventually disbanded, it had examined over 1 million people and treated over 440,000 cases in just 5 years. John D. Rockefeller Sr. wrote to the members of the commission saying that the work thus far accomplished would seem to have brought about in all of the southern states a very general knowledge on the part of physicians, health authorities, and the public regarding the prevalence of hookworm and the methods of treating and preventing it. The chief purpose of the commission may thus be deemed to have been accomplished. And what's noteworthy here is he wasn't necessarily talking about the outcomes, but the knowledge that had been built and the capacity to keep solving this problem. This organization then evolved into the International Health Division and moved on to global public health goals. There are two lessons here. First, the innovation of the field of public health, which was truly a departure from traditional models, depended on the engagement of a very diverse set of professionals, from medical professionals to churches to the press. And second, the resulting connections among these actors created a lasting infrastructure that would address many more problems in the future. So this brings me back to the question that I was asked, why innovation is so important. And my answer was that it solves problems today in a way that positions us to keep addressing the unforeseen problems of tomorrow. This is partly why we gave our centennial year the tagline, innovation for the next 100 years. We're confident that the past century of commitment to innovation will help us break even more new ground in the coming years. Now, I just returned from a trip to Africa where I was lucky enough to visit iHub, which is a cooperative workplace for tech innovators and entrepreneurs. And you can imagine what it looks like, a big open loft space, big tables, laptops, coffee machine, music in the background. And it was very energizing. Now, among many of the cool projects that were described to me, one stood out. What they were doing is they were using Global Positioning System, GPS, which was originally developed by the military in the 1970s, to help save the rhinoceros. What you can do is implant a GPS chip into the horn of a rhinoceros, and when the rhinoceros is being pursued by a poacher, it accelerates in a very unique way, a way that has a defined signature. This signature can be detected and wardens can be dispatched. So basically, if you're deciding to hunt a rhinoceros, you're going to get hunted by a warden in the short term. And this is remarkable. And it's an example of the continued benefit of innovation, of which GPS was a major one. First, a military use. We all have GPS chips in the smartphones that we carry around, and now it can be poised to help save a precious endangered species. Incremental improvements have far less potential for this kind of ongoing and future impact. So to me, it is this forward-looking potential that makes innovation so central to resilience, another theme of the day, obviously. The way we address today's acute shocks and chronic stresses sets the stage for how future generations will do the same. This linkage between innovation and resilience will guide the design of 100 Resilient Cities Network. And this interplay between present and future benefit is also why the Rockefeller Foundation is constantly scanning for promising innovations. We can apply our risk capital and convening capacity to help civil society, government, and the private sector overcome the temptation to privilege incremental solutions and instead take the risk to try bold ideas that can have transformational future impact. Today, as part of that scanning, we want to celebrate innovation successes that create impact today and will likely keep creating impact in the future. We want to shine a light on the good work being done by other organizations and individuals that can serve to inspire and provide us with new ways of thinking, working, and approaching problems in all of our organizations. Earlier this year, we asked the global community to nominate organizations and individuals who are making a difference for poor, vulnerable populations through innovation. After receiving over 1,000 nominations from the world and through a process that captured over 10,000 votes, we are thrilled to present the three 2013 honorees of the Next Century Innovators Award. From a platform to ignite creative thinking and nurture innovation among Sierra Leone's youth, to innovative partnerships between historic adversaries, to creating new linkages between urban and rural economies through water conservation, today's awardees have reframed, reimagined, and recombined intractable problems to create transformative solutions that will yield benefits today and in the future.